creates and God is the source of all good. Spread the word about all that God has done. God's encouragement is continually there for God's faithful people. God's covenant holds fast for 1,000 generations. Let us pray. You call us to a generous way of being, O God. When our praise and prayer come from the heart, you cheer us on. When we listen carefully and encourage with sensitivity, your presence is felt. When we help carefully and share our rewards sacrificially, your word is heeded. And as we look up at the cross, we know how far generosity can go. You give us all we need for the life that is good, living God. So when we hoard selfishly and refuse to acknowledge the needs of others, forgive us. When we take our Christian community for granted, when we ignore the Bible's teachings, forgive us. When we will not spare time for reflection and refuse the ways that lead to peace, forgive us. When we share generously, praise lavishly, and give without the thought of getting, you cheer us on. Cheer us on, loving God. Amen. The hymn, Immortal, Invisible, God Only Wise.
Immortal, invisible, God only wise. In
reading from Psalm 145, verses 1 to 8. I will extol you, my God and King, and bless your name forever and ever. Every day I will bless you and praise your name forever and ever. Great is the Lord, and greatly to be praised. His greatness is unsearchable. One generation shall laud your works to another, and shall declare your mighty acts. On the glorious splendor of your majesty, and on your wondrous works, I will meditate. The might of your awesome deeds shall be proclaimed, and I will declare your greatness. They shall celebrate the fame of your abundant goodness, and shall sing aloud of your righteousness. The Lord is gracious and merciful, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love. And a reading from the book of Jonah, chapter 3, verse 4, and chapter 4, verses 1 to 11. When God saw what they did, how they turned from their evil ways, God changed his mind about the calamity that he had said he would bring upon them, and he did not do it. But this was very displeasing to Jonah, and he became angry. He prayed to the Lord and said, "O Lord, is not this what I said while I was still in my own country? That is why I fled to Tarshish at the beginning, for I knew that you are a gracious God and merciful, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love, and ready to relent from punishing. And now, O Lord, please take my life from me, for it is better for me to die than to live." And the Lord said, "Is it right for you to be angry?" Then Jonah went out of the city and sat down east of the city and made a booth for himself there. He sat under it in the shade and waited to see what would become of the city. The Lord God appointed a bush and made it come up over Jonah to give shade over his head, to save him from his discomfort. So Jonah was very happy about the bush. But when dawn came upon the next day, God appointed a worm that attacked the bush so that it withered. When the sun rose, God prepared a sultry east wind, and the sun beat down on the head of Jonah so that he was faint and asked that he might die. He said, "It is better for me to die than to live." But God said to Jonah, "Is it right for you to be angry about the bush?" And he said, "Yes, angry enough to die." Then the Lord said, "You are concerned about the bush, for which you did not labor and which you did not grow. It came into being in a night and perished in a night. And should I not be concerned about Nineveh, the great city, in which there are more than 120,000 persons who do not know their right hand from their left, and also many animals?" And our epistle reading is from Philippians chapter 2. Philippians chapter 2. Reading verses 1 to 11. "If then there is any encouragement in Christ, any consolation from love, any sharing in the Spirit, any compassion and sympathy, make my joy complete. Be of the same mind, having the same love, being in full accord and of one mind. Do nothing from selfish ambition or conceit, but in humility regard others as better than yourself. Let each of you look not to your own interests, but to the interests of others. Let the same mind be in you that was in Christ Jesus, who, though he was in the form of God, did not regard equality with God as something to be exploited, but emptied himself, taking the form of a slave, being born in human likeness, and being found in human form, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Therefore God also highly exalted him and gave him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of the Father. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Our ministry of music today will be done by Sister Amy Crowder. How great thou art.
Thank you.
to thank Amy for that special item. And I greet you, the viewing public, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Let us pray. My talents, gifts, and graces, Lord, into your blessed hands receive. And let me live to preach your word, and let me to thy glory live. My every sacred moment spent in publishing the sinner's friend. Amen. Let the same mind be in you that was in Christ Jesus. About 4 years ago, I listened carefully to two testimonies shared during worship service by Nancy MacArthur and Madge Foster. Nancy spoke about the joy she found in knowing that God loves her, and the different ways that the Holy Spirit comforts her in this assurance of love. Madge said that she experienced God's healing in her life and the life of a friend when they both identified who or what the enemies were. The enemies, she implied, are not in human flesh, but in the principalities within the heart, those emotions that make us feel that we are more important than we are. After listening to these two stories, I became convinced that God is doing something extraordinary in our lives, and that the life of the church here at Knox is blessed and enriched. I'm confident that the faith of many have been strengthened to boldly declare God's mercy and love as we sense the Holy Spirit moving among us and within us. It is a beautiful thing to know that God is moving amongst us, and our experiences are good enough that when they are told, they could be a blessing to those who hear them. The church must keep this fire burning and guard the burning flame. Nothing should cause us to extinguish this flame. The declaration of God's love through Jesus Christ is the foundation of faith building and the foundation of a long, loving, and ongoing mission. Keep love burning. Paul encourages the church at Philippi to keep love burning. In one of the most important texts in all of his epistles, Paul said, "Let the same mind be in you that was in Christ Jesus, who though he was in the form of God, did not regard equality with God as something to be exploited, but emptied himself, taking the form of a slave, being born in human likeness. And being found in human form, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross." Many scholars believed that this letter was written as a thank you note to the head of the church in Philippi, and that in that letter, Paul encourages the church to stamp out all pride, division, and selfish deceit that may exist among them. Paul was fully aware that the church was under threat to break up because of some political split precipitated by two jealous women, Eudora and Syntyche. Doubtless, They were campaigning bitterly against each other because some election to an office in the church was at hand. The Philippian church was about to split because members were taking sides. As they fixed their attention on the one they are supporting, rather than on the faith and dedication to the gospel. The text that I have chosen for today calls the church to guard against selfish ambitions in the church and offers the model and formula for the loving and thriving church. The model and formula must be adopted from the life of Jesus, said Paul, and that is why the text is referred to by many as one of the most gracious Christian letters that was written. Here are three formulas he gave for a thriving and loving church. They are a humble church, an obedient church, and a self-renouncing church. These, he said, were the supreme qualities of the life of Jesus, and they must also be the hallmark of every Christian church. Selfishness, self-seeking, and self-display destroy our likeness to Christ and our fellowship with each other. But the self-renouncing of Jesus Christ brought him greater joy and glory. It made sure that someday, sooner or later, every living creature in the universe would worship him. It should be noted that true worship and devotion come from love. Worship and devotion emanate from a heart that loves. Jesus won the hearts of people not by blasting them with power, but by showing them a love that they could not resist. Paul implies that when people gaze on the humility, obedience, and self-renouncing of Jesus in his death, then we will bow the knees and worship him. Worship and service are not about immediate success, but about love that will make it hard for people to escape. This is the mandate of the church. The church's business is to worship God in spirit and in truth. To promote such worship, we must first gaze on Jesus and adopt his qualities of humility, obedience, self-renunciation to make worship loving and the church thriving. Nicholas Rowe, was a United States Army officer and one of only 34 American prisoners of war to escape captivity during the Vietnam War. Colonel Rowe was credited with developing the rigorous survival, evasion, resistance, and escape training program taught to high-risk military personnel, such as special forces and air crews, and the U.S. military doctrine with institutionalizes these techniques and principles to be followed by captured personnel. Rowe was captured by the guerrillas in the Vietnam War and escaped to tell the tales. He saw his capture as Peter sinking in the water because Peter had taken his eyes off Jesus. When he returned to his home in the USA, he addressed a military parade in a stadium and referred to himself as a rescued man who was sinking in sin. He was saved, he said, because of his love for God and God's love for him. And so he pens these words. I was sinking deep in sin, far from the peaceful shore, very deeply stayed within, sinking to rise no more. But the master of the sea heard my despairing cry. From the waters lifted me, now safe am I. Love lifted me, love lifted me, when nothing else could help, love lifted me, love lifted me, love lifted me, when nothing else could help, love lifted me. Let us be humble, obedient, and selfless, and our lives and our church will grow in love. Let us pray. Fill our hearts with your love, O God, and pour your love into the hearts of everyone in this world. Rescue us from the sinking sands of life and from the sorrows and pains that beset us. And let your glory shine in this church and in the world and in our lives. In Jesus' name, amen. The Lord's Prayer.
Jesus Christ, He said,
to God. We give not because it is our duty, but because of God's unlimited generosity to us. We give not just to help those in our fellowship and neighborhood who are needy, but to bring hope to persons unknown to us. We give not just these gifts of money, but our best talents and abilities, and the priority of time to be used in God's service. We give loving God, always mindful of your measureless gift in Jesus Christ. Amen. I trust that you have enjoyed the service today, and we note that for the rest of this month, there will be no drive-in service. We shall inform you by way of newsletter how we shall proceed on the 4th of October. Trust God's blessing upon you and your families as you celebrate. Take on the spirit of humility, the spirit of love. Sacrifice self for the sake of Christ, and you will find joy. The closing hymn is a hymn, "Take My Life and Let It Be."
Be with us all now and forever. Amen.